you got a new episode. Remember, like, share, subscribe, download on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, anywhere where you do your bullshit, YouTube, all that. We got a pretty exciting episode today. We have Chris Slater and Damien Norris and Chris Stewart, who run the Alabama Strongman. It's their 10th anniversary, and we figured it'd be a good way to get it out there to all the competitors, people that want to come watch, put a podcast down, the video talking about the growth of the event the past 10 years, where it started, where it's going, and talk about some of the events that are going to be there today. So if you want to start kind of just where it started, or maybe let's talk about where you guys start Strongman. Let's start with you, Chris, and then Damien, then we'll go to you, Chris, then you go right into the Alabama stuff.
Sounds good.
So where are we starting?
Yeah.
So let's see. So for me and our Damien and my story is kind of similar. So we started lifting at the YMCA, right? That's where we were training individually. We didn't really know each other, and we both were lifting fairly heavy for a YMCA, you know. So we kind of got paired up in there, started training together, just heavy lifting. And then I can't remember where we saw it. We saw a flyer or something for an Alabama Strongman. I think it was ASM 3.
On Facebook, I think.
I think it was Facebook. ASM like 3. Yeah. So right after Slater got it kicked off and started. So we went to check it out, showed up in Gulf Shores that day, and went and watched ASM 3. And at the end of it, we were like, well, shit, you know, we can do that. And then got hooked up with Slater after the contest, talked to him a little bit, and at the time he had his Alabama Strength facility over there in Foley, and that's kind of where we got started. We started with Slater at Alabama Strength and started training strongman. And I think our very first competition was Mob City, 7 or so years ago now?
Yeah,
so
14, 15, somewhere around there.
So, and it's kind of we've just kind of kept on from there. So the last 7 or 8 years, we've trained and competed, and we both have done more than we ever thought we would in the strongman world when we started.
Yeah.
Being able to, you know, qualify for Static Monsters, you know, and do that thing, and then the big one for us would be OSG, you know, World's Strongest Masters, you know, in Daytona. We both qualified and been able to do that twice. So for a master's athlete, I think that's probably probably the pinnacle of a for master's athlete. We've been able to do that twice so far, and
awesome.
No signs of slowing down yet. So as long as my body will let me continue to do it, we're gonna do it.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
That's kind of my story.
Hi, Damien.
Yeah. About like Chris said, the way we started between me and him together is about the same. We got over there with Slater, and we talked to him in a second, and we had no clue. There's never been strongman in the South. He brought it down from Michigan for us here in South Alabama. You know, people played with it over the years, and we got down there with him, and never imagined we would have fell into the situation with him. Not only being a great coach, he was just so knowledgeable about the sport and the forms and the techniques, and he had the equipment, you know, come out of his pocket personally. He purchased, and he had an open-door gym down there, man. He wanted to get the sport down here, and he sacrificed his time and family and money to grow the sport at Alabama Strength. So we all started going down with him, and, man, as you know from in here at Amp Performance, it's not like powerlifting per se or any other sports. It's, you know, you get over training, somebody don't have nothing. Even in comps, it's just like a family. It's more family-oriented sport.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you're competing and you want the guy you're competing against to do just as well as you do. You know, it's not like football where you got separate teams and you're playing against each other. Even though you're competing against each other, you're still wanting everybody to do well.
It seems like strongman and CrossFit are the only two kind of iron sports that are like that. You know, like once you finish the line, you're going back to cheer on the other people. Everything else, it's like, fuck them. Like, I want to beat their ass. Like, I don't care about them. But strongman, like, if somebody's struggling and there's like 10 seconds left, everybody's on the line like cheering for him, clapping for him.
Absolutely.
You know, want to either deadlift or pull the yoke through the line, things like that.
Yeah, and that's what, you know, which Slater, I've told him over the years, me and Chris both, how fortunate we was to not only run into somebody about the sport, but him being so knowledgeable and just open to train people. I mean, did we ever pay you anything for training? I mean, it was just – I mean, we'd drop our fair little drop-in fees, but there wasn't no, like, I mean, you know. it wasn't. He just Tell didn't. Me. He didn't put money first. He wasn't like, you know, I'm in this to.
Sounds like he's got an invoice coming.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
No doubt. Right. But anyway, it just it took off from him knowing what to do and how to do things and to get to where we was at. You know, because when we get to nationals and the Static Monsters Worlds and the OSG World's Strongest Masters. I mean, you don't know where you're at when you get there. Then when you get there, and you're like, okay, we obviously know a little bit, but yeah. Maybe obviously not a lot. But he prepared us enough. Our first year when we went, we both finished top 20 in our first year. You know,
yeah.
And you know he gets a lot of credit from that, or not all the credit. You know, yeah. He obviously didn't lift the weights, but without his knowledge, you know, what we learned over the past 8 years, nine, whatever years.
Yeah.
You know, you watch videos, YouTube stuff, whatever, but. It comes down to having somebody right there, you know, yeah. Telling you to pick the shit up.
Yeah. And that's before we get to Chris, do either of y'all, like, remember, you know, was it, like, a specific lift or, like, a movement or something that, like, where you knew you were hooked? Because, I mean, I did CrossFit for a while, and I know exactly. I mean, I can go back to the workout that I was like, yeah, this is for me. And then getting into Olympic stuff, you know, I mean, you know. Like, was there a moment, like, you just, like...
Or, like, an event that y'all saw?
Yeah,
like
was there...
ESPN, or, like, you went to the Alabama and just watched, you're like, fuck.
So, I think for me, and Damien can give his take on it. So, for me, at ASM, the first one we went and watched, I think for me, there was a car deadlift, if I'm not mistaken. And I think for me, it was the car deadlift, probably.
Yeah.
You know, to see those people, you know, men and women both, go strap up and grab a frame.
Yeah.
And actually pick a car up off the ground and to see it move.
Yeah.
I think for me, that's what hooked me to strongman. I'm like, that's cool as shit.
Yeah,
I want to grab. You know, I want to do that.
Yeah,
you know, I want to pick cool shit up, and the people watch you and they're like, oh shit, he just picked up a car. You know.
Yeah, I don't know if there was a better iron sport ever made for TV.
Oh yeah,
because it's, you know, it's always like something cool.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, that's, and for me, like talking about the lift, I think it was the variation. You know, maybe not so just one lift. You know. Coming to gym, you bench, quad, deadlift, dumbbells, you know, your typical whatever, any gym in the world. But when you get into strongman, you know, from the Atlas stones to the car deadlifts, I mean, they're in, like, the press. You never press a bar. It's always a sandbag or, you know, an axle or a log or, you know, now there's stone presses. Just the variations is what got my attention so much, you know.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, more so than just one. But like Chris said, you know, ain't nothing cooler than watching somebody pick up cars or, you know, big round concrete balls. Uh-huh. I mean, it's
pretty cool.
Yeah, it's interesting.
We found this huge rock. Pick it up.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And when you're looking at steel in the back, you pass on the interstate, you see a trailer full of steel or something, you know, they're thinking about going to the scrap yard, and you're thinking, damn, what can we make out of that?
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, that's the truth. Yeah, that's
and I think everybody's looked at those big red balls outside Target going, I'd like to try to pick that up.
Yeah.
Well, what's that weigh?
All right, where'd you get started, Slater? Kind of just from the beginning, since you brought it down here whenever you moved to Alabama from Michigan, and then kind of go right into the first Alabama. Like, what was your thought process?
Yeah. First of all, thanks for having me. I appreciate the time. This is a cool opportunity. I got started, and I was thinking the other day, I was like, when did I do my first comp? Looking back, it was 2008 when I started. I was actually getting ready to do a bodybuilding show because I got done wrestling. I wrestled at Eastern Michigan University, and so I wanted something to be competitive still and still compete. And so the trainer, the guy that owned the gym was like, do a bodybuilding show. I was like, all right. So I got trained. Then I got sick about 4 weeks out. Screwed up my whole prep and everything. I was like, well, screw this. I'm done. After cutting weight so much for wrestling and stuff, I was like, you know what? I'm done. And then, so there was a flyer for a strongman show, local strongman. It was NASS back at that time. And it was not, you didn't have all the weight classes. It was a lightweight at the time. So it was 231 and heavyweight. There was two weight classes. That was it. There was no novice. It was it. Yeah. Just two open classes. And so I was talking to the guy at the gym. I was like, hey, can I do this? He goes, why not? Go try it. I'm like, all right. Well, I've never touched a log before. There was a log press. There was a semi-pull, farmers. It was natural stones. We had a natural stone load. And I've never touched any of this stuff. The guy at the gym, he welded two handles on two barbells for farmers carries. Talk about hard farmer's carries.
Yeah.
Long and hard. Oh, my God. That didn't come out right, but. but that's how I, and so I was like, all right, so I tried it. And then there was another guy at the gym that signed up, and he was kind of an ass. And so I was like, I don't care if I don't, I'm not going to finish last, and I'm not going to lose to that guy. Those were my only two goals. I didn't want a zero, and I wasn't going to lose to that guy. And I didn't lose to that guy. He finished 10th. I finished 9th. And I was like, all right, well, cool. And then I came back the next year and did it again and took 3rd. And I was like, all right, well, maybe I can do this. And then so I went from doing one comp, and the next year I did 2. There was a comp down Ohio that I went, and I took 2nd down there. But, shoot, down at that one, I never touched a yoke before. And to see how I did a log, it was – oh, it was ugly.
Glad it wasn't cell phone videos.
Oh, yeah, it was ugly how it went. But shoot, and then that's kind of how I got hooked. And you asked about what event was it. Yeah. It was pulling a semi. Because I remember sitting up there going, can I even move this thing?
Yeah.
And then after you see a couple people in front of you, like, all right, they're moving it. Like, okay, well, it can be done. And that was like, that's it.
Yeah.
That's cool.
That's awesome, man.
So doing the semi. So that's how I got started. I moved out to Maryland for a little while, and the guy at the gym was like, you know, he goes, just start picking up some equipment. He goes, you can get a little crew going. Doesn't cost you much money. Well, he said it didn't cost you much money. You know, being a gym owner, how much equipment actually costs, and you guys now know too. Starting to piece this stuff together. This stuff's not cheap. And that's kind of what I went on Craigslist. I found a beat-up yoke that I still have that was a big cut in the middle of it. I had one of my old wrestlers' dad welded it for me just to kind of keep it together, and I got a log. I did buy a log, and that's kind of where I started. I got a stone mold, and I just slowly got equipment in there. But then when we decided to move down here in Alabama, there wasn't – Strongman Corp didn't have a state chair at all, and I was like, I'd like to put on a competition and just do something different. It's not down here. Let's see if we can get something going. And so I did that. So I contacted Dion at the time. She's the CEO of Strongman Corp. And I was like, hey, I'd like to – what would I need to do to be a state chair in Alabama? She goes, well, you got to put on a contest. You got to bring us in so we can kind of see you run it and then go from there. I was like, all right. So I had to fly her in, put her up and everything. So I had this comp set just with the equipment that I had. Yeah. I had some farmer's handles. I had a card. At the time, I would go over every once in a while over to Milton. They had some strongman stuff over there and a crew that I would go once a month or once or twice a month over there. And so they let me borrow some stuff. And that's kind of how I got started doing it. We put on our first contest. It was in November. Yeah. I had 14 guys sign up for this thing.
And we moved it. Why?
I don't
know. To August.
Okay. I'm just August, November, a little different here.
Because it wasn't hot enough in November. I figured we needed to be a little warmer.
Additional challenge.
We solved that problem.
Well, here's another question before we go further on about the first comp. When you moved down here, because you came from Michigan and Maryland, and I'm from up north, I'm from Virginia, so the lifting is different up there than it is down here. Like, when you moved down here, were you shocked that there was, like, no strongman, the powerlifting, just, like, it was weird. Like, sports are huge, but, like, minus, like, football, baseball, like, were you kind of like, man, what the fuck's going on with all the iron sports or just in general? You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, just when I came down, like, I was at – I was at a Y. Like, I had my stuff in a storage unit down by the airport in Gulf Shores where I would have to literally pull it out into the parking lot, train, and then put it off. It was more work to pull the equipment out and put it back than it was the actual train. Yeah. But, like, nobody – it was just these little commercial gyms, nothing – like, you couldn't use chalk in any of them, and it was like – what? So there wasn't – I was like, where can I train to do this? Well, yeah, it was weird because up in Maryland, with you up by – because I was up by Philly and all that stuff, there's comps all over the place, and there's plenty of places to train.
Yeah.
But you come down here, I was like, wow, where – what's going on?
No, and it's still kind of – it's a lot bigger now since, you know, you've been doing this for 10 years. The strongman's growing down here, but, like, with the weightlifting, it's still slow. And I feel like powerlifting, I mean, it's only up in North Alabama and, like, you know, the Pensacola area. I mean, in Mobile, it's still like, man, what's going on? Like, when I was in middle school, high school, there was guys training Westside at the YMCA.
Yeah.
So, like, I was like – I saw that at a young age, and I got down here, and I was like, there's no weightlifting, there's no powerlifting. Like, what the fuck are we doing at Omni?
You think it has anything to do with the weather, like – you know, it's we get two seasons hot and hotter. I say that on a cold day, but you know, but up north, you know, it's cold. It, you know, you can't be outside doing stuff, so you know, you're going to be drawn into the gym more.
I think
because I was going to ask, like, when you, I mean, he started in 08, then he moved down here, and it wasn't here. Well, but I remember watching World's Strongest Man stuff as a kid on ESPN.
So this is what I think, and you can elaborate on this, like, from growing up in Michigan and playing wrestling in college in Michigan, that football is big everywhere, but, like, down here, it's like ride-or-die football. Like, if high school coaches lose a season or two, like, they're fired. We're in Virginia, like, it's big, but it's not, like, the same. You know what I mean? Like, everything is thrown straight into football and baseball and maybe volleyball now down here. Whereas, like, the other states, minus, like, Texas and Florida, I don't think it's the same. Do you think that could be it?
I agree with you 100% since I'm a head wrestling coach down here. And you can tell that, I mean, the state of Alabama, it's football. I mean, that is their pride and joy. It is football first and everything else second.
Yeah.
And I agree with you. But going, I think, even Michigan, they had a club high school powerlifting thing.
Yeah.
You look at Mississippi.
They have it.
That's a high school sport in Louisiana. And I think Mississippi this year, they had, I want to say it was like 700 athletes competing in their state meet.
We have, when Aaron and Trinity came in, they said they competed in powerlifting in high school, and I thought they just competed. But it was like their school sport.
Yeah.
And then in Florida, they have weightlifting teams where I think it's clean and bench press. And maybe press. Yeah. It's something weird, but like they compete in weightlifting, but they have like a power clean, a bench press, and some sort of squat variation. Alabama, it's hard to, I mean, you know, it's hard to get these kids to dress out for gym class.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Shannon's daughter, she was a good friend of ours that recently passed away. His daughter was a big powerlifter there in West Florida.
Yeah. It's just slow. Like, football's king down here, and then after high school football and Alabama football, it's like people just don't want to do anything.
I mean, Jeff, he did make a good top, you know, good point. There's between the river systems and the gulfs and, you know, I mean, there's just a million things other to do down
there. Yeah, that's like
way.
You come in on a Friday, like there's nobody here.
There's
no kids class. There's nothing. Nobody comes in except the people that want to train. Yeah. Like, you're just coming for exercise. Like, see you Monday.
Right.
Well, I had, when I was, when I first moved down there, I was doing some personal training. I was over in Fairhope, and I had a client one time said, we were scheduling out for the week. She goes, I can't do Friday in the afternoon because that's when I start drinking wine. Honest to God, that's what she told me. I was like, I don't know what to do with that. It's like, can you do the morning? She goes, I got to get the kids to school. I'm like, okay, you do you. So it's just different. It is.
This isn't for you.
That's funny. All right, so that's what I thought was going to be your thought as well with everything down here, being not from the state. So let's talk about your first event then. Like, how did it go? The hiccups, the good, the bad, the emotions. Because I know, like, the first time you run something, if it's big or small, like, something's going to go wrong. You're going to have to fix stuff on the fly. Events may not run correctly. It may have just been you having to judge everything. Like, you know, I don't know. Like, how was it the first time? Because nobody's really, like I said, nobody did anything down here.
Yeah, I think I had like four people to help me.
Yeah.
And then Dion was there. She said I could help judge or whatever she needed me to do. But she, I think, helped judge one event, and then she was sitting down. So, whatever. But I think from the get-go, and these guys know, too, like, I mean, we're always kicking around ideas. What can go wrong? I did that from day one. I tried to have a plan. Yeah. All right, what could happen? Because at the time, we did a farmer's event, and I was worried about the clips falling off because it was a front-loaded farmer's as opposed to being on top. And I was like, well, if the clips, what do I do? And so I put, like, three clips on these things to make sure they didn't fall off.
Yeah, because I'm sure at that time, they probably didn't have axle clips. Or they did, but they weren't easy to find. Because, you know, like, some of the farmers, like, the actual pipe is a little bit bigger.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. No, and there was no pro. I didn't have any pro locks or anything like that. So I had to climb them down as best I could. But the first one I did, I paired up with a guy that did a push-pull meet.
Okay.
And he just didn't have very many people do it. And that was a lot of work for him to get his stuff
there.
Nobody's really sure. He had a few people do it, but there wasn't. And so I was trying to make it bigger that way. Having two events going on and everything. So as he probably had maybe 15, 20 guys do it from there. But, again, for the most part, it went it went really well. I kept it simple with the equipment that I had. I wasn't changing a bunch of weights. I think it was a log. It was a farmer's car deadlift, a keg carry, and a stone over bar. And it actually went really well. It was overcast, so I was worried about the weather. Matter of fact, the day before when I was dropping my equipment off, I was testing the car deadlift by myself in the pouring down rain. Because I had to get this tested and figure out where it's going to be. And with car deadlifts, you're like, you don't know. I mean, it could be really light. People are going to get 25 reps, or they're going to get three. Yeah. And it ended up being a little bit lighter. But it actually went really smooth with only 14 guys. I mean, not a whole lot can go too terribly wrong. Dion was very impressed with how everything went. She said I was very organized, went things well. And that was more or less what she was concerned with, make sure it was organized.
Was things like that. Your first one, has it always been at the Hangout?
Yes. Yep. My wife's sister had a contact at the Hangout, and then so she asked, and of course these guys didn't know what the hell was they were getting into. Like they have what are we doing here? And I'm like, I was trying to explain it. And of course they don't know. Oh, yeah. And I was kind of like, you know how you see on ESPN, not like that, but that kind of
version of that,
that kind of thing. And so like. They're like, all right, but you're going to need some insurance and this kind of stuff. So they charge us a ridiculous amount for insurance after that. But then after they saw it and they understood what we were doing, that's when they got on board and they wanted to back it a little bit more.
Well, cool. That's awesome. Because, I mean, like where it is now, it's huge. I mean, you can't find a parking spot. You have to park a mile away if you get there just to watch, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, it's slammed. Like there's constantly people in the restaurant. And if people don't know what the Hangout is, I mean, the people that own the Hangout, they own that whole street, I feel like.
You know? Oh, but yeah.
They own everything down there. But the Hangout is like the main restaurant where just everybody eats, I guess, down there at the beach. But it's like it's constantly filled with people just watching the strongman. Yeah. I mean, like it stays full the whole time. You can't get a table unless you come early. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a really, really cool event. Well, it's not too big either to where everything is right.
Yeah. I've been very fortunate with them that, again, you can't argue lifting at the beach. You can't do it. It's a perfect venue. There's bathrooms. If people want to drink, they've got the bars there. They got food there. There's stuff for the kids can do in the sand pits and things like that. They can go over to the beach itself. It's a perfect venue for us.
And I think that's the same reason like yours is successful and then Beach Brawl at Pensacola is successful because it's at the beach.
Yeah.
Like people are going to come to the beach.
There's a draw.
They may just come to the beach and all of a sudden they say, what is all that noise? What is going on? Mm-hmm. They come watch and then now it's an every year thing. They come watch.
And that's great. They'll come out from the beach and say, hey, what's going on? And so they'll stick around and watch for a while. And that's really cool to see. And sometimes I get lost in things that are going on. I'm looking around and like, where the hell did all these people come from?
Yeah.
Good Lord, there's a lot of people sitting around.
Another good thing, too, about, like, the beach and the way the comp runs is still in the vacation time of the year. So you can – if you're going to fly, you know, spend thousands of dollars to fly into a comp or drive 8-10 hours, you can kind of piggyback a vacation off of it, and a lot of guys and girls do. So that's another cool thing about the Alabama. You can come down either a week early, which most stay after.
Yeah.
You come down and compete Saturday – you can take the next week off, and you're in one spot. You can kind of get a vacation out of it. Yeah, and you can bring your family because, like Chris said, there's tons of stuff for the – you can go compete, and your family can go to the beach instead of being stuck in a coliseum or convention center somewhere where all you can do is watch a bunch of people you don't know lift, you know. So Alabama does open up a lot of doors for families to come down and be able to do other things other than just sit and watch people lift.
I don't think – we've all competed in quite a few comps and – know local and other states and all that. I don't know that I've ever been to another comp or competed in one at a better venue. To me, that's the best venue that I've ever competed
All three of y'all have competed at big events. I mean, you've all competed at statewide, worldwide, nationwide. I mean, so that's saying something because y'all have competed at the highest level besides the ESPN. World's strongest man, you know?
Yeah, we've been to nice venues and well-ran competitions, obviously, but as far as a cooler place, for competition, I don't know if there is one.
Well, there's not a better run comp either.
I thought that was obvious.
Especially, you know, when you see Damien halfway through, sweat like can't see his shirt, it's soaking wet, sweating. Right. Bitching, moaning, God dang! I can't. These people—they don't know what they're doing.
Somebody's got to relieve me. I got to eat.
I just try to live through the day. Like, That's my goal.
Or he'll just disappear and sit in the bathroom because it's air conditioned in there. Yeah. He did that one year. He literally pulled a stool in the bathroom and sat in there.
Like, where did Damien go? I don't want to go too far and not remember or forget. Where Slater's talking about that, the first Alabama, you know, having 15, 20 people, four events, you know, this is just last year. I mean, we was at the hangout, same venue that he had number one at, and we had 140 people and four lanes for five different events. So, I mean, you know, that's national, you know, that's national type things, you know, and this is an amateur competition. Yeah.
140 competitors.
140 competitors, four lanes going from 9 o'clock to 4 o'clock.
Yeah. I'll say, and we were done and cleaned up by 4 o'clock.
That's awesome. Absolutely.
And nobody, you know, everyone had plenty of time between events. I mean, and like we sat there last year, it's like, what was it, April? Last year it filled up in April?
Yeah.
Did we make it, even make it to May?
Well, yeah, but I was at 100 people in April.
How many people over the cap did you go last
year? Yeah, like since it's gotten so – let's start there. Like, when did it get big? Like, when did you, like, holy shit, like, we have to – not expand, but, like, I'm going to have to get more people to help. Like, this is a much bigger event than I ever thought it would be.
Still there.
I mean, it's still growing. Like, which one did you – like, holy shit. We started at 14, then maybe went to 25, then all of a sudden, like, maybe year three or four, you're, like, at 75.
Well, that's kind of how it went, and – And Dion kind of says you'll grow each year. You keep running good comps, you'll grow each year. And that's exactly what happened. I had 14 the first year. I think I had 38 year two. I think year three was right around maybe 60. And then it kept going up from there. But honestly, this last year was like – I was like, oh. Like when we got – like you said, we got to April, and I had already met my cap. I'm going – all right, this is a problem. It's a good problem, but it's a problem that we're going to have to deal with. Yeah. And that's when we decided we need to go to four lanes. Man, that's the only way we're going to get through this.
During COVID, that's incredible. Yeah. You know, so many other competitions and events and stuff are
– well, and that's the thing, too.
We're hoping to just have it, and you're like, wow, we have to expand. That's incredible,
that
man.
COVID year, that first year of COVID, and we're like, I'm talking with the hangout, are we still good to do this? And guy's like, yeah, we're good, we're outside. He goes, we're just not going to push it out on our stuff and promote it to try to get a bunch of people down here. I was like, that's fine, but we still had 75 people that year come down
that year. And like, I think that year, even, I mean, you ran it really well, and I think you started late because of the rain or something, right? The year before, the COVID year.
Yep.
Was that like you were supposed to start at 8, didn't start to 11?
We got a little bit of a pop-up shower there, and then we had a wipe everything down and then let everybody rewarm up. So we lost about, I would say, probably 3 hours. That was a 3-hour turnaround.
Yeah, that was
we lost.
9 o'clock year.
Yeah.
The band called us that year.
No, that's what I'm saying, because then you're like, holy shit, we got to keep rolling because the band's about to get on stage and, like, y'all finished up good. And, like, this year, like I said, you expanded the four lanes. I mean, it was smooth, and it's just a better watch, too, when you have, like, four different, like, multiple things going on at once. Like, that's the one thing that kind of sucks about weightlifting is, like, all right, I'm sitting there, I'm watching a kid or a lady or whoever do a snatch clean jerk. They get off the stage, it's quiet, there's golf claps, like, fuck.
I couldn't do that.
So, like, when you go to a strongman, or, like, even a CrossFit, it's like, with you guys, four people going at one time, multiple events going at one time, people screaming, cheering, music going loud, people cracking open reins and monsters and bangs, people passing out, EMTs running around, other strongmen helping people up because they're EMTs, like, it's just a much more visual and a pleasing environment in sports, you know?
Well, and that goes back into what Damien was saying. I mean, it's a family. Everyone's cheering everybody on. Yeah. I mean, you get some assholes. You're just going to get that in strength sports.
In everything.
Yeah. But they're few and far between. For the most part, everybody's cheering everybody on. Like you said, you want to have everybody have their best day because that's when you want to say, hey, I won this, and everybody was at their best day.
Yeah.
And it's if, like you said, like – I've done a few powerlifting meets, and it's awful. Yeah. Like, to sit there and wait for those flights to finish up when you're sitting there going, holy cow.
And powerlifting might be the worst because you have to go through – everybody has to do their squat, and everybody has – it's like – powerlifting meets are like 15 hours long sometimes. Yeah. Depending how big they are.
Oh, yeah. You know? And some of these ones around here are big.
Yeah.
It's like, oh.
And we've been fortunate, too. I mean, over the years, even just when we – because we transitioned, me and Chris transitioned from – competitors to helping Chris at Alabama, which I never competed at Alabama. Chris did. But we, you know, when we started helping him, we kind of start seeing the other side of the sport. you know, not just go train and compete, you know, because this year, well, Alabama was over in August, and we take about a week or two, and then it starts talk for the next year. Yeah. I mean, it's, right. But we've been very fortunate back where I was going over the years. The people we've met down here doing this have got to be such great friends. To have the help, you cannot do this with three people.
No, no.
So, I mean, I know there's going to be some guys at the gyms that may listen to this, hopefully, but you know, like Andrew, there's so many.
That's about it.
Amanda and Rick, you know, Amanda and Rick over here.
I mean, all your wrestlers that come every year and help out.
Yep.
But then you know, like Slater's wife, Katie. I mean, people don't see what she does, but without her, there's a lot of stuff.
I mean, you have the two ladies, I think, every year. I mean, one of them might be your wife, always putting the numbers in the computer.
Yeah, that's my
wife.
I
mean, like, you always have people
doing the computer stuff. Yeah, then, like, his mom and dad flies down from Michigan. Like, you know, hadn't been down a couple years because of COVID, but, you know, it just takes so many people to get this thing to go off the ground. And then even, like, just with your gym, to give you some, you know, accolades as far as helping with weights. I mean, just being able to use things from here and then having the max out here to help. So even though you're not you're not influenced so much at helping with the comp, but without things that you have,
four
lanes aren't possible.
Yeah. Like you just call them, like, hey, we're going to use this. All right, just take this, because, and you don't have to worry about, fuck, we're going to find extra bars or plates.
And that's a stress sometimes. Like when we said, all right, we're going to four lanes, we got to find equipment for
but,
all this
you know,
stuff.
I mean,
that's what we did.
But it was a 15, 20-minute worry about things. We go, hey, you know, hell, what are we using? And then we talk to you. And we have unlimited access to what we need here. Yeah. But at the same time, if you need something from Slater, you know you're more than welcome to borrow anything or use anything for something you need from him. So that's what we've been fortunate enough to have, you know, great people in our strongman community here in South Alabama that comes out and helps and supports. I mean, from actually loading plates to putting in scores to borrowing equipment, you know, it's just – we didn't even have to think a whole lot about the four lane. Yeah. Whereas, you know, you go somewhere else and somebody talks about doing four lanes, you know, maybe for one event you may have four farmer carries handles, but to have four lanes full of equipment, four judges, you know, you got to have two to three people at each lane to help load and get ready for each athlete, you know. So there's a lot to it, you know.
I don't know if everybody knows that everybody that comes out and helps Slater, obviously the people that are directly related to the competition know, but these people are volunteering their time. Yeah. You know, Slater's not paying these people. There's no benefits to coming out there and running around in 102-degree heat in August, you know, loading weights and moving equipment, you know, 600-pound yokes that people drop halfway, and you got to get that damn yoke back to the starting line, you know, so – everybody does this because, you know, they're big supporters of Slater and what he's doing, and they enjoy it.
No, and I can appreciate it, too, because you guys helped when we had the weightlifting meet. Yeah. And I know Chris had the biggest blunt of it, having to change weights the entire time. But, like, hey, like, you support the gym, you come, you help out, that's what you got to do, and it gives back, you know what I mean?
Sure.
Well, that's it right there. It's the giving back thing. People will say, how can I get back from the sport? Right, putting on a competition – that's how you give back to sport. Unless people do that, they don't understand what goes into that and what's all entailed. You will work out. You'll have more of a workout helping at a comp than you actually do competing in the comp. It's actually easier to compete in the comp.
Like I said, when we're up there watching and I see you guys having to move the sandbags or the yokes or shoot, even when Mike's broke ass would come up with his broke leg and broke back. carry shit around.
Got to give a shout out to Mike. Mike's a workhorse.
Oh, yeah.
Carrying everything.
Let's go into this year, kind of how many people you have signed up, thought process, and then kind of if you want to go into the events, the order, and how you want to do them, and if you want to go over that, but just talk about this year's.
Sure. Well, again, this was the 10-year, so I want to do something different. I mean, I was kicking around with these guys, just some different ideas, because that's a problem too. Every year is, and then we're starting to get. And again, one of my goals when I started this was to grow the sport down here. So now we're having comps over here. There's going to be a comp in Montgomery this year. And there's Rick and Amanda's having a comp in May, I believe. Louisiana's starting to have some more comps, Mississippi. So it is growing down here. And that was my goal when I started, because it was not down here. There wasn't anything in Mississippi. There wasn't anything in Louisiana. It wasn't here. And so that's what's awesome to see. But then with more and more comps, it gets a little trickier to find events that you can do that's different. So you're not doing the same thing. The same comp year in and year out. And that's the thing I want. I want people to come back because it's different.
Yeah.
I don't want people to come back. Well, that's what they did last year. Okay. I'm not going to do a same event 2 years in a row.
No. And that's just like I said, the people get bored with it. They get annoyed by it. And me and Bacon have talked about it with Beach Brawl. Like, it's starting to get it's the same shit on the rig every year. It's the same numbers. And people are starting to get bored of Beach Brawl because it's like, fuck, I'm paying $120. And I'm doing the same exact CrossFit events that we did the year before. You know what I mean? And like changing it up is what people want. They want to do cool things. They want to pick up new. They want to see new implements that they've never seen before.
And so that's what I kind of, again, with these guys, I could not do this without them. That's for sure. But it's like we'll kick back. Like I said, we started and I had people message me in December. What's going on with Alabama next year? Like, it's December. Like, well, everybody just pump the brakes a little bit. It is December. I'm working on it. But that gets a little fire in me to kind of figure it out because people want to know, which is awesome because they want to sign up for it. So I was trying to do something different, and I think we got some pretty good events this year. But one event we're going to do, it's a little different. It's going to be a yoke into a log press. They're going to carry the yoke 25 feet, turn around, bring it back, and then they're going to run down, and then they're going to clean and press away on a log.
So max reps on the press?
Max reps on the press, yeah. So it's something different where it's going to have a little more strategy because before people just do yoke.
Yeah.
They have certain equipment that they wear for yoke, and then if people press, they have certain equipment, so they're going to have to figure out.
What they want to wear, how much they exert on the yoke compared to the press or the press compared to the yoke.
Yeah, so it's something different that I thought, all right, that's cool, let's do that.
Do you have the time domain yet? Is it going to be a certain, like, 60 seconds, or is it, like, till you fail on the
press? No, it'll be 60 seconds. Okay. So they'll get max reps they can get in 60 seconds. So with clean and press, it'll cut reps down. So
and the clock starts when they pick up the yoke, or they have 60 seconds to press?
No, the time will start with the yoke.
Okay. As soon as they lift it up.
So the yoke's not super heavy. For that reason, the log's not.
Yeah, it's just fatiguing them.
Yeah.
To make the press a little bit more challenging.
Again, just something a little bit different.
Yeah. People got like, shit, I got to be in shape.
Yeah.
In shape this year.
Right.
Like me, for instance, I wear lifters when I press.
Yeah.
But
well, I do too.
You can't run a yoke with lifters on. You know, just like you're saying, look, like my belt for log is different than my belt for yoke, and a lot of people is. You know, you wear a lot stiffer, tighter belt for yoke. Well, you put that belt on, try to bend over, pick up a log, you couldn't even bend over.
Yeah, you're going to have strategy having it on loose and then putting it on tight when you go do the.
Well, so not only is it a different event, it's different in strategy because it's not, like you're saying, it's not the same. You got to figure a lot of things out. So, yes, that event is different than just a run to a press.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things you got to take into consideration, what you want to do in your training leading up to that, you know, which is pretty cool, makes it different.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that was the first event. And then generally the Alabama is one of the stronger show or the heavier shows in this area, and I do it that way for a reason.
Okay, I was going to ask, is that on purpose?
Yeah. Because they used to do level systems in Strongman Corp, and mine was always a level 2, and they're supposed to be a little bit closer to what you're going to get at Nationals weights. They've done away with the level system, but I still like having to be stronger.
Do you do that so when someone wins your competition, they go to a national event, they don't shit, they don't like.
And they're
like,
a little more ready.
Yeah. And it doesn't look bad on you. Like you push somebody, won your event, and they can't do the deadlift.
And there's a lot of events that happen that people will win and then they go on, they'll zero everything.
The reason I say that is when we went to the Arnold this year, we were watching the amateur strongman, and I couldn't tell you how many females and guys couldn't do the first deadlift.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, how'd you, like, I was texting Damien. I was like, how the fuck do these people? I was like, first, I was like, why is Keith not here? And then, second off, I was like, why is he not here? Then, why are these people not being able to deadlift? He said, half them people, they won competitions that just weren't as heavy, and they probably shouldn't be there, you know?
And the Arnold's a little different, too, because that's heavier than a Nationals event will be.
Yeah.
And that's kind of how they design it. They want half that field to kind of zero.
Yeah.
And that's a good gauge right there.
Gotcha.
They really want, you got to be at your best for the Arnold.
But normally, if you platform in Alabama,
you're ready.
If you put not platform but podium, you're going to be able to go to Nationals and be competitive.
Not per se
that you're going to win Nationals, but if you can win compete. The Alabama, you will be able to compete at Nationals.
Yeah,
you know, and that's just no doubt. A a lot of guys over the years, just in my, mine and Chris's 6-7 years in this, we've seen the guys from the Alabama go on. You know, you got like Ryan Saxton.
Yep.
Tyler Davis.
Yeah.
I mean,
Bob Schwantz.
Chris.
I mean, you have Colt. He was at the Arnold. He did really good.
Yeah, I mean, like all these guys has trickled through the Alabama over the years. I mean, like Ryan Saxton, he was just, and Tyler Davis, they both competed international.
Yeah.
You know, but they started at the Alabama. So, you know, the weights, they was able to do the weights and be competitive at the weights at the Alabama. So that, I mean, you can see where it does piggyback from this comp, per se, to bigger events that you could do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, because like Chris, you know, he won. Win the Alabama in the Open?
So, you know, no, I've never won the Alabama. I'm glad we got that on the I'm glad we got that out in the Open. But, thanks, Damien, for that.
Put a little salt in that wound.
But in your defense, you're competing in the Open, heavyweight Open.
I was competing in the Open. I never did the Alabama as a Masters. I have done it only as an Open, and I have podiumed 2 or 3 times in the Open at the Alabama, yes.
But, you know, and just like me, when my amateurs events over the years in Mississippi, that Mob City and stuff, you know, winning them and like Chris placing in the Open, when we go compete as Masters in our classes, we've done really well. I mean, you know, it's prepared us, and you know, I keep coming back to Slater, but you know, his knowledge, without his knowledge of the sport over the years helping us, I mean, that's why so many people helps him.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess to go way back, you know, an hour ago we started this conversation. He don't charge for his. I mean, he does program writing and he does personal training.
Yeah.
But on Saturday morning, we was all together. You know, it was just, you know, we all gonna pick up a bunch of heavy shit and lift.
Yeah.
And you know, he was there to, you know, he wouldn't stop his training, but he'd go, hey, get your shoulders back, right?
Yep.
Scoot your feet up. I mean, little cues like that that you go, okay, I'll do that.
Yeah.
But you start adding them and they start snowballing. But by him doing that over the years with Rick and Amanda and us and all these different competitors, when he calls and goes, hey, you know, think we can help do this, nobody ever second guesses helping because we know over the years what we've got out of him.
Yeah.
You know, so kind of put it all together, the whole conversation, that's why.
Yeah.
And that's why we're here where we are today. And the same thing with Jake, you know, with Jim. I mean,
absolutely.
We've done things in here helping and doing, and you know, but you don't mind helping people that help you as well.
Exactly.
You know.
Yeah, it goes back to that community family thing.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
That's come up 5 or 6
times. And that's
why
I don't understand why the hell people, and I'm going to give Amp some props here, why are you at Club 4s? I mean, not saying that them gym crunches, they're not great gyms. They got great equipment. But you go in by yourself and you lift and you go home.
Yeah.
I mean, you've been at work all day. You know, everybody's jobs and stress. Why not come to a place that's more family-oriented? Because we jackass around here half the time we're here.
Yeah.
I mean, it's always somebody doing. You got Cody's. You know when Cody's here, something stupid's going to happen. You're going to laugh.
Cody's here. Him, he's going to get Damien all fired up on something.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
yes.
I mean, it's just always. You know, then you got Josh Birch. You know, when he's in here, it's going to be some shit about sumo or dead. You know, you know, but it's just a good time.
It's a good training environment. People, you push each other, too, like as much jawjacking as we do and messing around as we do. When we're in here, we're all pushing each other to train. Like, I mean, everybody's training. Like, once you touch the bar in here, you're training. You're not just working
absolutely.
Out.
Yep.
You're training.
I mean, unfortunately, I think what you get the people that are training at the Club 4s and the Omnis and, you know, Crunch and all this, I think that's the environment that those people want.
Yeah.
I think the people that want this kind of training environment and that want to do this.
They're going to find us.
They're going to find you. Yeah. They're going to be here. That's what they want, you know. But I think a lot of them kids and a lot of them people training, they don't want this. You know, they don't want to put – you know, how many people over the years have come to us and went, oh, man, that strongman's so cool, let me train with y'all. And they show up once, and they go through our workout.
Yeah, that's it.
And are like, what? Shit, that ain't for me.
Yeah.
You know, I can't do that. And we never see them again.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you got to want it. Yeah. And I think a lot of them don't.
Yeah, I was about to say, there's a lot of people at Club 4, Planet Fitness or whatever, that just wouldn't fit in at a gym like this.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And I think Chris nailed it on the head. They don't want it.
Right.
Back to the Alabama. We did get off.
Sorry.
Aren't we talking about the Alabama and the events?
One event in or one event in. Four more.
All right. We brought car deadlift back this year. And that's just
–
everybody loves car deadlift. I mean, it's cool.
Yeah.
It's a pain in the ass to set up to try to get it so there's 30 reps don't win. But it's just – everyone understands, hey, that's a car.
Yeah.
And it's cool.
And like, is the car you use is what affects how many reps they can get? Or is it like the apparatus itself? What?
Yes, both done that.
Oh, really?
So depending on our handles on the car deadlift frames will pull out, and the further out they are, the little easier it is.
Okay.
But same thing, if you put a heavy-ass car on there, doesn't matter where the handles are, it's not going
yeah.
It's not going to move. So there's some trick to getting that. But, again, everybody – they love to put that on their Facebook profiles or their profile pictures.
Absolutely.
They got a car because it's cool. It's
a wow factor for sure.
Yeah. So those are our first two events. These are not in any specific order, by the way. We're going to do a sandbag press. So they're going to have to clean and press each rep for 60 seconds, a sandbag. And that brings some challenge into it because if anybody's ever picked up a sandbag, it's not fixed. Mm-hmm. It's not like a barbell or something where it's not going to move on you. Once you move that, once you mm-hmm. pick that sandbag up, that sand's moving on you. And so there's some challenge to that.
Yes.
I think. So again, something different that we even had. That's third event, fourth event. Now we were kicking around ideas on that. And actually you guys are the ones that kind of made me think about it. And I was like, wow, that makes it a lot easier on our end setting this stuff up. Originally it was going to be an axle squat, to boxes. Kind of what they did, similar to what they did at the Arnold with the pros.
Yeah, they've been doing a lot more like some squat event at strong, like the Arnold, World Strongest Man. Yeah. They've been doing a lot more squat events with like a fixed bar yep. or something like that.
And so I thought that would be cool, and we kind of talked about it, and then Damien calls me one day, and all you guys were talking, I'm like, why don't I do like just a yoke squat for a max? And the more I thought about it, I was like, that's perfect. Because you go from a car deadlift for max reps and then have to do an axle squat for max reps in 100-degree heat, somebody's going to die. or somebody's not walking away from that. And I was like, this is perfect. So what we're going to do, it's essentially a bottom-up squat with a yoke. So we're gonna set them in their parallel position. So quad's going to be parallel to the ground. We're going to set them down, and then they're just going to have to stand up. Max weight, they get three attempts to pick up as max weight as they can. And it's something different. I've never seen
it. That's going
to
suck.
It's going to look cool. Oh, my God.
It's awesome, and it's going to suck.
I can remember when Damien brought the topic up of you wanted to do some sort of squat variation at the event this year. I was like, man, why don't you just like a yoke squat? Like, it'd be easier to set up. Like, just like when they come in to measure their yoke, like, you don't have to worry about changing bar heights. Two pins, boom, boom.
Yep.
And then, like, it looked fucking cool.
Yeah.
Like, get pictures and videos of people max out like 800,000 pounds on a yoke. You never know. But it's just something different. Like, nobody's ever done it. And they have to train.
And they might have. I've just never seen it.
No.
I've never seen it.
And they're going to have to train like Anderson squats out of a rack or like yokes. They're going to have to train for that event.
Yeah.
You know?
It's a safer event as well. I mean,
if you fail, you're not going to pick it up or you drop it. It's not going to crush you.
Yeah.
Because back a long time, at the very first of this conversation, me and Chris, our first competition we ever went to at Alabama. It was on the side of the hangout. Mm-hmm. All right, so we walk up. We're on the steps. The time we walk up, Slater's judging. He had a yoke, an axle, clean and press. Then they go right beside it to a log clean and press and go back and forth.
Yeah.
So the first guy, me and Chris, walk up. We're standing on the steps. Slater's in front of him. Guy cleans the axle, gets it overhead, and throws the damn axle. Look, Slater goes over the axle. The axle's going out through the people.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so – that's other things that we have to figure out between us when we're doing Alabama. You know, you've got 2,000-3,000 people at a time that's standing around. You know, kids, women, children, this, that, and other.
You have to make sure it's safe. Make sure people don't do dumb shit.
Just know when you sign up and buy a ticket, you're going to sign a waiver.
About, you know,
they do.
That was one of the things when we got to this, talking about this event with the yoke. I mean, if you get to the top and drop it, it's, you know, the leg, it's going to stop right there. We don't have to worry about the bar rolling out through the people, picking it back up off the ground, getting it back in the rack. I mean, it's going to be a cool event. I mean,
that's going to look really cool.
It's going to separate some people. There's going to be some people up top and, you know, top of the leaderboard that's going to get to that event and, you know, shit to bed.
Yeah, and I just think it's going to be really cool just watching someone max down a squat. You know, like in a local amateur competition, like nobody, like, I mean, you see it, like you said, at nationals or, like, you know, on TV, but, like, at a local comp, like, I guarantee you more people are going to start doing some sort of yoke squat now.
Well, and what it does is it brings a different group to the comp.
Yeah.
Okay, sometimes you got, like, powerlifter-type people that aren't going to do a strongman because it's, like, the medleys and things like that.
Yeah.
But now you're going to add two, like, a car deadlift and a yoke squat. And matter of fact, there was a guy messaged on Facebook. It was like, I might come out of retirement now for this because it's something cool. It's something different.
It's different. Yeah. You have, like, two real strength events, and then you have two strongman, like, medley type events. You have, like, strongman events, which
brings, like I said, a whole different character of people. Because I remember 2 years ago, God, what is his name? Real strong guy from, is he living in Atmore? You know what I'm talking about? Redhead with glasses. He's a power lifter, but he came into the Arnold. I mean, the Alabama.
His dad used to own a big gym. Guy.
He bench like 500 some pounds. You know, he's younger than me. He works at the steel plant.
Is it Cameron
Moss?
Cameron. Yeah. Like, he's a power lifter, but he came out and did because he had, like, strong, like, max deadlift or something. Like, stronger events.
That, so that year set up well for him coming from the power lifter
world. Yep.
Yeah. And I think he won that year. Because remember he left, had to go to work.
Yeah, he was top two or something. Yes. I don't remember what
podium.
It was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, and he had, like, literally minimal training. But that's the good thing about what Chris is talking about with this Alabama. He tries to make it to where people can bring crossover from other sports, whether it be CrossFit, powerlifting, you know, or amateur novice division, just getting into it. You know, so.
And then our last event is going to be a sandbag over bar. I spent all this money on sandbags last year, so we're going to use them.
Now, over bar, is it going to be a yoke height or is it going to be a throw?
Not a throw. No. Again, that comes into safety issue. We don't have the space for that, nor do I have the time for that. It's just going to be a sandbag that they're going to load over a bar. I don't remember if it's like, for the men, it's like 56 inches, 54, 56 inches, and then women, I think it's 50. But what's nice about the sandbag is it's different than a keg or a stone where we got to roll it back to them. We don't have to do that here. They're going to go and get it themselves. So they're going to go and load it on each side of the yoke. So we don't have to, it's safer for us.
And you're not having to move as much shit this year.
Yeah.
It's a lot easier for you.
Smart. Right. Just roll all the
work smarter, not harder. Right. You had to, I remember last year, like those two, they had to redo the keg every time when the either, what was it, the keg over? Or was it keg
we didn't max
it. Like, because half people wanted vertical, half people wanted sideways. Like fuck. Shit,
yeah. Just, and you try to help the competitors out. You know, they've been there all day. You have too, but you still, and it all goes back to when Chris first started this. There's a bar for the Alabama that everybody's held to, you know, whether you're helping or lift. So you want the athletes to have the best experience as possible.
Yeah.
You know, whether it be as simple as reset the keg. Yeah. I mean, that makes a difference when it comes.
Oh, it does.
You get to the 50 vent, your ass is already dragging.
Yeah.
And if I've got to pick a keg up, set it, turn it before I go, and then if not, you got, you know, us guys doing it. I mean, the little things like that over a 6-hour day adds up, you know. Yeah. And that's what separates Alabama from a lot of.
And that's why I keep doing this. Yeah. I mean, because you get people come up to us and they're just so thankful. Like, this is an awesome comp. You guys did a great job. And that, at the end of the day, it's 2 days that suck just from a work standpoint. But when you hear stuff like that, you see people have success and do things that they didn't think they could do. That's what brings you back. It really is.
And you guys always, I mean, the events are announced, the loads are announced. Is that a safety issue for the athletes? Is that just the way Strongman's always done it? Like, you know, coming from Iron Sports with a CrossFit background where, you know, there's always that unknown and unknowable. So you don't, you know, you find out some, but maybe not every detail until day of. You know, is it, you know, have y'all ever thought about, you know, kind of mixing it up where there's, you know, you don't necessarily, there's that kind of unknown element?
I would love to do
how you adapt to it on the day.
But at the end of the day, people won't sign up for that comp.
Okay.
That's what it is.
They just because it's
that's you got not, people that.
Is that the strongman kind of just their training mentality? Like they like to know what it is?
Or they want
to
know what equipment you're using. Okay. They want measurements on things. I'm like, y'all, just pick it up. I mean, that's what it comes down to.
Yeah.
Like, what's the handle height? This and that. Does it matter? Right. I mean, let's go. But they want. Like, especially when you get towards nationals, people will ask some silly questions like, what's the pick height or how far? Really? I mean, get stronger.
Just curious, like, you know, that adaptability, you know, piece.
As I said, I would love to do that, but people aren't going to sign up for that. They want to know.
Yeah,
they really do.
Strongman, they want to know because, I mean, there's so many different variations of deadlifts, of presses, of carries, of loads. I mean, there's just so many different things you could do. And if you didn't announce any of the events – what you would have to, how would you put your training together?
Not necessarily all of them, but
one surprise.
Yeah, there's like, or there's a piece of it, like, hey, there's going to be a deadlift event, and that's all we're telling you, you know.
And there are some,
you'll find out at the athlete brief at 8 o'clock exactly what it's going to be. Yeah. You better figure it out during the day.
There are some that try to do that. Again, I think their numbers go down. Like, Dion does that for the finals of the amateur She doesn't tell them until that week what the last event is.
No, I'm just curious.
But again, that's only a small percentage of people. Yeah. And at that point, if you make it to the main stage for the Arnold Amateur,
you better be good enough.
You're going to be okay for whatever it is. So, but,
All right, so we went over the four. Is it four events?
Five.
That was the fifth event?
Yeah.
All right, so what do you think was going to be the separator this year for everybody? Because usually there's like one event where there's usually the top three guys are kind of tied up or like close, and then there's like one that just – like last year with Keith. Like Keith and what was the guy's name he got second? The guy with the tattoos, big guy?
Dennis.
Yes. Like they were like neck and neck. Dennis might have been ahead.
Well, there was three of them. That Daniel Tate was right in there too. It came down to the last – it literally came down to the last event.
It came to the keg on – was it the keg over the keg on?
Keg over bar, yeah.
Keg over the bar, you know. Like came like he had – Keith had to hit the highest – The highest gig, you know.
So, you never know. I think this yoke squats is going to be different enough. That's going to throw people off. The sandbag press is going to be a little different because people aren't used to pressing sandbags. You never know what car deadlift. Somebody's going to get something ridiculous. Yeah. They always do, even though if you try to make it heavy. But other than that, I don't know if unless you guys can think of another one that I think.
The heat's always a factor. Yeah.
That is too. Yeah. Just you never know competing outside in 100 degrees in 100% humidity.
Yeah,
it makes it a little tricky.
You come from up north or you know even over Mississippi, wherever, Georgia, and you train in a gym all day.
That's right.
In an air-conditioned gym.
Yep.
And then you come down to Alabama and it's 98 degrees, 100% humidity. It is a different training. It's a different environment.
No, for sure. Yeah. And I think that's one thing, because you train in your garage majority of the time, and I doubt you have air conditioning in your
garage. I do not.
And I know we don't have air conditioning here.
We do not.
So that's one thing I think people need to realize, like when you need to train in the worst type of environment. Like sometimes with crappy equipment, because when you get the comp, like you don't know what it's going to be there. It could be great equipment, could be air conditioning, could be anything, or it could be at the hangout in August, 100 degrees, 100% humidity, like
wind blowing, sand.
Wind
blowing, and then all of a sudden it rained, so that something's even off. It's slippery.
Yep.
Like, you have to train uncomfortably because you never know what to
expect. And I totally agree with that. Just from training my garage, and then I go to a comp that's indoors with air conditioning, let's go. If I haven't even broken a sweat yet, we did that at Dallas.
Absolutely.
We're in there in Dallas. Like, I haven't even gone through one shirt yet because I haven't sweated through it, and I feel good. I'm ready to go.
Yeah.
That's like the Alabama, you know, the most things you bring to Alabama when you, like us guys, are shirts. I mean, you bring four or five shirts throughout the day.
It's more than that.
Yeah. Just set up that morning, Rex, first one.
It's like every event, you change a shirt, change your hat.
Yeah. You have to.
Gotta put some baby powder on. Like, I chafe just watching. You know what I mean? Like,
it is not good time.
Yeah. No, I learned. You got to use a little gold bond, a little bag bomb, something. You're going to have to put some kind of protection down there.
Sure. Well, do any three of y'all have anything else you want to add to the Alabama or to Strongman or just talk some more about training or philosophy, anything before we wrap this thing up?
I just sit here and talk all day about it.
Yeah, we could. And, I just want to thank you for the opportunity to come do this. This is awesome. Strongman, like they said, it's something completely different. I got hooked after the first competition I did. And it's just a different environment. It's fun. It's unique. It's not boring. People's like, oh, I can't do that. Yes, you can.
Anybody can do it.
Everybody can do it.
Yeah. And I think that
you don't have to compete. Just go train with it. Go do something different. I tell you what, doing farmer's carries is so much better than sitting there doing crunches.
Yeah.
It's a better core exercise right there.
You know, one thing I want to get out there for whoever may watch this is what we hear a lot of the times is they're like, well, I want to try that. You know, I'm like, well, come train with us. You know, come to the gym, train with us and see if you like it. And they're like, well, I can't do the weights y'all can do. Well, that's not what we're saying. We're not saying we'd expect you to come to the gym and be able to do a 300-pound log your first time. It's just getting in the gym, getting out of your comfort zone and trying something new. You know, pick up a log, pick up a yoke, and just try it. Nobody's expecting you to do 300 pounds on your first day out. It's you know, it took Damien 7 years to, you know, to get up to where his press is,
like,
and Mr. You know, Masters, you know, world record deadlifter over here. So you know, it's taken him years. You know, it's taken all of us years to get there, and I think that's what people don't understand. And I want them to, that you don't have to be able to lift that weight. Just give it a shot.
No, and I think that's one thing just in training in general people have to realize is just because you're scared, you might be intimidated by what people are lifting or how they act on their videos after they lift or before the lift. Like, they weren't always there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, we weren't always there. Like, you weren't always strict pressing 315 in the seat. You know what I'm saying? You weren't always doing your deadlifts like you are. You weren't always doing a log like you were. I wasn't always snatching 360-some pounds. Like, we all started somewhere,
right,
and somebody helped us get there.
That's right.
Somebody that was where we're at now, we watched, and we might have been a little afraid or a little intimidated, but, you know, we bought into what they were teaching and how they did it, and look where we are now. I think that's one thing people have to realize is don't be intimidated. You might be a little intimidated, but it's not what you think when you come into a gym like this. Like, you might think you're intimidated, but how many mom and dads and just normal gym folk do we have that come here every day? That's the majority of the members.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And I think what – and this – for anybody that hopefully listens that's never tried it or done it, you don't have – like you just said, you don't have to be a strongman athlete to do – partake in a strongman training because, you know, you see people – like you said, crunches. You know, the farmers, just the core work. Well, I mean, the sandbag carries. Like, you see people doing the training in the gym – whereas some of the things that you can do in strongman, you're getting crawled. You know, you're not just laying on a bench doing a crunch. You know, you're doing sandbag carries. You're doing cardio work. You're doing core work. Your lower back. So the strongman events just work so many different muscle groups with one implement. You know, you can go back and do sandbag carries. You do a few runs of 50 foot with sandbags. You know you've done something.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that's what a lot of people miss out on the strongman. You know, workouts or implements is what the crossover, or the, what am I? You know, what am I trying to get at? The carryover to other strength implements or strength quality. So you're not just laying on a bench doing bench press, working chest. You know, you picking up sandbags or logs. You know,
doing yoke presses.
Yes, I mean it just works so many different muscle groups, from a 100-pound female to a, you know, a 350-pound guy, there's something for everybody that I think the people get a lot of, a lot more crossover. Well,
and I think if more people would train, even if they did some strongman stuff once a week for some conditioning or cardio, like, you would transfer over to their CrossFit training, their weightlifting, their powerlifting, because it's just the unknown of what are you doing that day.
Yeah.
Like, holy shit, we're going to run with a 150-pound sandbag for 50 meters, and then we're going to have to do a wheelbarrow back. Like, that's going to transfer over to sport. Any type of training, just general fitness.
And that's a fight that we're fighting right now. I'm in with the National Strength and Conditioning Association. I'm on the Strongman Specialist Group committee. And that's what we're fighting right now, is just getting some exposure to these high school and college program and professional programs and just your general fitness people. Like, hey, Strongman can help you.
Yeah.
Okay, you don't have to do a 300-pound log. You don't want your athletes doing that style of training. Yeah, but farmers carries and just simple things, sandbag carries, keg carries, things that, I mean, I'm not a huge tire flip fan, but that people associate tire flips as well.
Yeah.
But you don't have to do these, Matt. You don't have to do a 1,000-pound yoke. You don't need to do that.
Yeah.
But you can do these implements that can, one, the kids find it interesting.
And it changes this. It changed their mindset because, you know, kids in school. I mean, all three of us work with kids at different ages and athletes at different ages. Like, they get so bored doing the same. Oh, we really have to squat today. We really have to bench today. We have to do cleans. Well, if you have them carrying a barbell 100 yards with 225 on their back, like, holy shit, that changes it up for them.
Oh, yeah. So, and it's just different. The people just needed some more exposure to it. And then, again, that was my focus when I started. That's still my focus now.
And I think if, like, what you're talking about, the NSCA, if a bigger school starts doing it, usually everybody else starts doing it. So, like, for instance, like, when we were up at the Arnold, I was talking to the Mars Bars guy, and I don't know if they want me to put it out there, but I don't really care, because I know they're not going to listen to this. But, like, Clemson has – they bought 20-some Mars bars, right? And I think that's everybody's favorite bar here to spot with, right?
I love it.
It's like the Mars bar. They bought 20-some Mars bars. And once everybody finds out they're using a Mars bar, all the other universities are going to buy it because they're top five in the country, you know? Right. So it's the same thing. If Clemson or Alabama start doing farmers carriers or yoke carriers or something like that, other people are going to start doing it. It's just the trickle-down effect from the top seeing the positives of those implements and that style of training.
Right. Absolutely.
But that's the problem with, like, the collegiate level is they're all cleans.
Yes.
And if it deviates from that, because they think that's the only way to get explosive. Well, I'm not all of them, but there's a lot of them.
I know what you're saying.
They've got that. That's what they've always done.
Yeah.
And that's what football, they just, everybody's got to do power cleans. You don't have to.
No. Football, it's, all right, we're going to do, it's so old school, we're going to do old school periodization. We're going to do power cleans, but they're going to call it power clean just a clean in general. They're not going to call it a clean. It's going to power clean from the floor. Right. You catch in the hole where they call a hang clean. You wrestle in college. You understand how it is. It's very – and you're in the NCAA, so you understand, like, it's a very weird place, college strength conditioning.
It is. And, like, my wrestlers asked me, why don't we clean? I was like, one, I don't have the time to teach you. And every time I watch y'all, like, football kids and do that, you're doing a reverse power curl.
Yeah,
that's what you're doing. I was like, I can do so many other things safer and get more out of you, speed squats or something like that, and I can still be explosive. But
box jumps, anything. Yeah. I mean, that's the same thing with my athletes. Not the ones that come here because I have time, but, like, at school I have 45 minutes from the time that, like, they have to get dressed, they have to get undressed.
That's what we do too,
And so it's like you really have, like, 30 minutes maybe if they're busting their ass. So do you really have time to teach a clean? I don't.
Properly? No.
No, and, like – with me, that's what I do. Like, I'm top in the nation in my weight class at snatch clean jerk, and I don't teach it at the school because I don't have time.
Yeah.
Because it's not safe. But we can do deadlifts. We can do pauses. We can do clean pulls. We can do box squats. We can do all these different things that can get them explosive.
Get the same result.
Exactly. Yep. Right.
In a safer environment.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Now, if we had some schools like Saraland, they have blocks. Like, okay, maybe we can do that because you have 90 some minutes to teach for weightlifting. But in the normal 7-period day.
No, you can't.
If you're doing it, they're doing it wrong. Trust me. When I walk around these schools and see videos, it's not. I mean, you've seen since little Ryan started here, how often he had, like, when he first started, every day was bar work, drills for 30 minutes every day, and then now he's finally getting it. But, like, you have to do it over and over and over again, and you have to stay on their ass. And when you have 30 kids in the weight room, and half of them don't want to do shit, you look over, it's reverse curl, it's deadlift, and
trying to get it up.
Yeah.
They're starfishing it.
Right. Yeah.
Well, that's for anybody listening in your area, South Baldwin County, where would they go? Like, if they wanted to come see you or talk to you or train or on a Saturday, where would they go over there?
Well, we got since I closed Alabama Strength, just because I went back into teaching and being the head wrestling coach now, I didn't have time to do both. So we train over at Ignite Strongman, which is at Rockin' Boot Camp in Foley. You can always just message me, and I can give you the information. But Rick and Amanda Kelly own that. And so we're there on Saturdays, usually from 9 to about 11 or noon is usually when we're there.
Yeah.
Well, here's a question about that, too. With you being the wrestling coach, with you, I know you've implemented somehow with your athletes the Strongman style of training. How has the carryover been when y'all have gone – to meets and states and area?
The kids that are in my second period weightlifting block, which I don't have everybody.
Yeah.
So I don't have the football kids just because they have priority.
Yeah.
Because it's football.
I get it.
They're much better. I mean, their core is stronger. They're just stronger.
Yeah. Their spatial awareness is probably better.
Yeah.
I'm sure when you see the kids on the mat getting thrown around, but then they can feel it, then they can reverse, and they can get back just from.
So you – and I've got a few kids that you can definitely just – physically see a difference in their physique and how different they are. And now I'm limited kind of with some equipment. We don't have a ton of stuff, but we can do carries and we can do all that kind of stuff. And we can do bar walks, like you said.
Yeah.
I do a lot of, like, buddy carries. It's the same thing as a sandbag. You got to manipulate. You got to pick them up. You got to carry them.
Yeah, I mean, because the weight's going to be awkward. Like, they might be bottom heavy, might be top heavy. How can you carry them?
Yeah, so they got to figure that out. And we do sled work and that kind of stuff, so.
I wish, like, more schools would do things like that because it's just going to benefit the athlete so much better. It's giving more and become more well-rounded. And when you listen to, like, people at the top of profession, like a Dave Tate or these Jim Windler, like, most of their stuff before they even have kids touch weights is going to be some sort of strongman carries or crawls or pulls because that's what's going to get them able to do true training, you know? Like, if your core's weak and you can't hold up a dumbbell, like, how the fuck are you going to put a bar on your back?
Yeah. I mean, you can't get in the proper form or use the proper technique if your core cannot support the weight to do it.
Yeah.
And a lot of people, I think, they skip that important phase of the training. Like, you're talking about with kids in school, you don't have time to teach the correct training. So if you just go into it, they're not going to be developed. That's where the injuries come in. Whereas, like you're talking about, even with Ryan, you know, you start and try to develop, get the body prepared to do the type lifts, and that's where I think some of these people
even just with squat progressions, like, they don't do that. They just immediately put them on the bar. Like, these middle school kids don't need a bar on their back. how about we do a goblet squat?
Yeah.
And like, if kids struggle with depth, I always start them with box squats.
Yeah, 100%.
And then we can take that box away until they can understand we don't drive our knees out. Yeah. These kids, they cave in, and we wonder why we're having ACL issues because we're letting them squat with our knees in. And that's, and part of that is just having other coaches in there addressing it and not just sitting there on their phones.
Other coaches that care.
Yeah.
Like, it's annoying because I'm sure you see it. I definitely see it with some of mine. Like, I'm in there, and the coaches, just they go away. Like, they come, do roll, and then they leave. It's like, like, you don't need to coach, but, like, you need to, like, hey, that looks bad. You know what looks bad.
Yeah.
Like, rounded back knees. I can't look at 30 kids at a time. And I think that's one reason why the volleyball team I work with is always either winning state or in the state finals is because they train harder than anybody in the state. I mean, they're stronger than probably the football team that's at the same school. They squat better. They run better. But it's like we started with goblet squats as 8th graders, 7th graders. Then we went to box squats. And now we're on free squats, but we still go back to box squats. But then we go high box squats to load them heavy so they can feel the weight. So then when they go back to a low box or a free squat, knees aren't caving in. I mean, there's so many ways to do it the right way and progression-wise that these football coaches, they just – they want to clean. They want to squat.
That's how they did it, so that's how they're going to have their kids do it. Yeah. And they're not really – a lot of them aren't open to
– No, the change or listen. It's very very frustrating, but
and that's the same, like, we're struggling with just getting kids to wrestle. It's because the football coaches don't want to buy into it and see the value of it.
It's very annoying. I think wrestling is, I mean, I wrestled in high school and played college football, but we have a kid in here, Tristan, who he hated football. You could tell he hated football ever since he started in 8th grade. Like, he just fucking hated it. I don't know if he didn't like the coaches, but he didn't care because he would do shit in here. You're like, dude, why are you moving so slow on the football field? Like, I see you jump and run in here, like, something's off, right? But then they started wrestling here in Mobile. And, like, he started wrestling, and, like, his mindset changed.
Yeah.
He started talking shit. He started having more energy. He started giving more effort. He started showing more just aggression and anger. Like, if he missed a lift, he used to miss a lift. Eh. Now he misses, like, at Nationals. Like, he missed his last clean jerk, which would have won Nationals. Like, not Nationals, Arnold would have put him number one in the nation. Like, he screamed fuck out loud as he could on the platform. He was pissed. He would have never done that before wrestling because the mindset. And if these football coaches let their kids wrestle, that want to wrestle, it's going to make them tougher. It's going to make them stronger. It's just going to benefit.
Oh, yeah.
Like, why would you let them play basketball and baseball, but you don't want them to wrestle? Like, wrestling is going to carry way more to football than those other two sports. Yeah.
Especially if you're inside the box. Your linemen need to be your linebackers. Unless they're a specialty kid that is a basketball player.
Yeah, I get that. Like a receiver or something. Yeah.
But
like
if you're or indoor track, and I get that. That's fine. But if your hand's in the dirt – You're in the box.
You need to know angles, leverages. Like, I mean, wrestling's all leverages. Like, if you have the right leverage on somebody, like, take them down, reverse. Same thing on football.
So it's going to make them a better defensive lineman. It's going to make them a better offensive lineman because they got better spatial awareness. Yeah. And we've worked that movement piece where they've got a – and so,
Chris, again, tell us –
that could be all day.
about AMP. Well, if you're in Mobile, how does Jake say it, Mobile?
Mobile, Alabama.
Yeah, if you're in South Alabama, you know, in this area.
So if you're in the Mobile, Alabama area or surrounding areas, and you want to, learn Olympic lifting or powerlifting or strongman
or anything really,
all of the above.
Yeah, we'll wear a black road shirt.
Yeah, AMP Performance here in the Mobile area, you know, come check us out. Give Jake Johnson a shout-out. You can hit him up on Instagram, Facebook, all the social media sites, AMP Performance. Go check it out. Reach out to any of us, really, myself, Damien, anybody, and we can get you hooked up and get you in the door and let you try it out. So,
as far as strongman equipment, what all?
So as far as strongman equipment goes – we've got it all, really. I don't know that there's much we don't have in this gym as far as strongman. We've got anywhere from – we've got axles, logs,
wagon wheels,
yokes, stones.
Silver dollar deadlift attachments.
I mean –
which come to be very beneficial.
You know, we just got a, you know, new Mammoth deadlift bar. So, we've got that now.
What do you call the thing that Tyler had Nevin make for the competition?
Iron the cross.
So, we've got iron cross. You know, we've got 8 stones, iron crosses. I mean, so – there's not much in the way of strongman equipment that AMP Performance doesn't have now. So
yeah, I don't think we. I'm trying to think if something that we don't have that you would compete with. I think we pretty much have
any competition that I've ever done or been to locally on a national or world level, AMP performance, has that had everything we've needed to train with?
Yeah. As far as even here, like last year, me and Slater went to Dallas. I mean, we never touched a silver dollar deadlift. Didn't have any clue. We was pulling this, pulling that, trying. You know, and then you reached out to somebody you talked to who had the national record in silver dollar or something.
Yeah.
So Slater, you know, it's like, it's different. There's no really way to simulate the silver dollar deadlift unless you've got a silver dollar attachment.
The width's just different, the height's different.
Yeah, so he talked to him about 3 weeks out before Dallas, 4 weeks out, and he called it, look, you know, he was like, you really can't simulate. You just pull, and get over there and do you can. So I said, hell with this. You know, I've been fortunate enough to make some great friends over the years, and a couple phone calls, a couple pictures, 2 or 3 hours one day, Slater comes over, we got silver dollar deadlift.
Yeah,
attachment.
I remember you were asking me about that. I was like, yeah, just take this old scrap we have in the back.
So we've been talking about the whole time about the, you know, people helping in the community or the family type orientation. Jake had an old rack back there that was perfect, that hadn't been touched in 3 years, and we went, chopped it up, come up with some silver dollar deadlifts, and ended up with two from South Alabama. Ignite or Alabama Strength and Amp Performance had two national records this year.
Yeah.
Slater set his for 231 or
242s.
242s, and I set the Masters National North American Silver Dollar Deadlift record. So, you know, I mean, it's just like the little things like that. And hell, we're sitting there waiting because they done rising bar, and there's me and him. It's like, holy shit, there's nobody left. We didn't come in yet. and he's going, dude, wait. Did we mess? I mean, we messed up because we're literally standing in the back. And
you have your suit on. You're like, fuck, like, this is starting to hurt. Like, I need to take this off.
Well, because everybody's out. We ain't even open.
Yeah.
He's like, dude, do you think we need to open? Like, well, we know our weights. I mean, we've already trained and we know where we need to open, but yeah, we may be fucking up here. So
that's what Damon's like. Should we open earlier? I'm like, no, let's just keep to our plan. Keep to our plan. Our first attempt was most everybody else's third attempt.
Yeah, and it was like, that was entirely too light. It was like, damn, you know. But so I mean, just shows you like the things that you've gotten us that we've needed here for the gym, and the things that Slater's been able to purchase and make. He's got some great friends down there in South Baldwin County that Brunson. A good friend of ours, is, we've met over the years. He's made some equipment, frames.
Those two frames for last year.
I mean, so we've had Mr. Nevin here has made wagon wheels for us, my buddy James Brenton. You know, we've gotten things because all this stuff's made. Yeah. But we've just been very fortunate to have people in the right settings to be able to do – to replicate implements.
And I think one thing, too, about, you know, what you're doing in Foley, what we're doing here is, like, if we want something made or done, it'll eventually happen. Like, we're not just talking smoke. Like, you know, when you guys were at the Y, I remember you guys were talking about, like, when you came here, you're talking about, like, they were going to get us this, just because they didn't want you to break stuff, which is cool. But, like, it would take fucking months to get a bumper plate or, like, a deadlift platform. But then they would get mad when you're deadlifting in the normal area. Yeah. Like, what do we do? Like, I don't get it.
You're dropping away.
It took them, I don't know how long, just for something as simple as an axle.
Yeah.
An axle. Was like pulling teeth. I mean,
it's.
But once again, that's not the kind of. We're not the kind of demographic the YMCA is targeting.
But here's the thing, too, though, with that is you guys were there before you did Strongman. It's not like you just came in there Strongman. Like, y'all were training there just working out, probably.
That's right.
Yeah, as like absolutely. Normal, just like gym pop. Like, you that's used right. to do the what are they called? The Tough Mudders and the Spartan races. Yeah, like, you'd work out there before, then you got a Strongman, but they didn't see that you were a longtime member and you accommodated. Here, it's like. Literally, like, people want to come. Like, we eventually will get new equipment. We will try to build stuff. If you become a loyal member and I trust you, then, you know, you'll get a key. Things like that, like.
Yeah, I think it goes back to what I was talking about earlier. It's if you want it and you want to do it, then you'll find a place that'll accommodate it and has what you need.
Yep.
The YMCA just wasn't willing to accommodate, and that's not what they wanted to do, and that's fine. Nothing against the YMCA, you know.
Yeah, no,
it has a purpose, and it serves the people that want to train there. That's what they do.
I mean,
but for us, it was not our cup of tea.
And even like the stone platforms, like, you know, Rick and Amanda over there at night, they wanted something different. So instead of cutting up the stone platform, throwing it away or whatever, Rick and Amanda donated their stone platform to Amperformer. So now we've got two huge stone platforms and God knows how many stones. So, I mean, it's just, it even goes back from gym to gym, not even just family in the gym. It's going the strong man community.
Yeah.
You know, the willingness to help even from gym to gym, not just person to person. And that's a big difference, too, I see. You know, because like in powerlifting, you know, they want their gym to be, we've got this from our gym.
Yeah.
You know, we've got two national people that's from our gym. Yeah. You know, they've got that. You know, they want their gym to be the spotlight, whereas in strongman, ain't nobody care. You know, we just want people to do great things from our area, whether it's at Ignite or, you know, AMP or wherever, you know.
So I mean, it's not bad to say you've got, you know,
no, yeah,
multiple world competitors, international competitors training at your gym, right, Jay?
No, that doesn't hurt at all. But, like, I think, like I said, it's like everybody trains together. And I think it's like when who blew his leg, his quads out at the Arnold?
JF Chrome.
When JF Chrome, like, you saw everybody, like, freak out and run over there to help. You know what I'm saying? Like, you might see him in powerlifting. You're not going to see him in weightlifting. But, like, that's just the community of strongman. Like,
or even just all the comments and stuff on Facebook and all that. And so social media. So it's crazy.
But, all right, I think we leave it there. And there is a good conversation about the Alabama, where it started, where it's going. The gyms around here. If you guys want to drop your social medias or anything like that before we get out of here.
Hey, give them some information on how to get in touch with you, your email or phone, whatever. Anybody who wants to get in touch with you about the Alabama.
Yeah, we do have an Alabama event page. It's Alabama Strongest Man 10. That is up there where they can get, and I post all information up on that event page. You can email me, alabamastrengthgym@gmail.com. Take care of that. I'm also on Instagram, chslater2. And you can message me there for any information. Our event is posted on the Strongman Corporation site. It's also on ironpodium.com, where that's the live link where you have to go in and register. So all information is there as well. So.
And it's up. Registration is open, right?
It is up. I think we've got about 20 people already entered it.
And you open it when?
Like 5 days ago.
Yeah, 20 people 5 days. I mean, it's anybody out there listening, if you even think you want to do it, it would be worth wasting 55, 60, what is it right now?
Early bird right now is $75.
So, $75, you probably got about a month to get registered. Yeah. It's going to fill up it really quick this year. And we're going to have to cap it off. So if you think you're interested, you may want to contact
Especially with the two max, like the two max reps and max effort squat. Like people are going to want to do that. So like sign up before it like sells out, because you're going to miss out, because who's maybe 5 years till you do another squat type event. You never know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
But, we want to just thank Jake for – appreciate it, man, for putting this on.
Yeah, this is awesome.
Getting to put it together for
Absolutely.
Us. Getting this opportunity to come out and talk about it and get to Alabama out there. Anybody interested, a little information. So, man, we appreciate it. Thanks, bud.
Oh, yeah, no problem. And don't forget to like, subscribe, share, download on Apple, Spotify, Podbean, the YouTube channel. We'll post out clips of this next week, and then we'll probably drop it on Friday. So – I appreciate everybody. Like, share, subscribe.
Thanks, Jake.
Thank you, sir. That was good.
Yeah, but you could probably just sit here all
day. Oh, easy. Talk about strongman all day.
Now you can see how podcasts are going to be.